Remember to like, share, subscribe and comment, and I hope that you enjoy this interview. Thank you.
You signed to a label, you were in different bands. So can you tell us about some of the bands you were in up to your journey to become
a soloist? Yeah, I was in some different bands. I was actually in a band, a couple different ones. One, some people that I still am good friends with. One was like kind of like a glam rock band. Another one was like this kind of like British mod. Like we thought we were like the Stone Roses, but they actually are that amazing. Like it was an amazing band. Like that was my thing as like a 15-year-old going into it kind of like that. Like I'm thinking I got my like mod haircut and all that stuff, you know, but that was an awesome band. And I'm still very good friends with the main guy, but I think I sort of took a turn where I just wanted to be self-contained, and the technology was like, you know, you could get a computer and, you know, all this whole new world of opened up to me. So I was like experimenting with like drum and bass and like house music and then all kinds of stuff, you know, like hip hop and whatever, you know, just anything where I could feel like I could control the process of the production. Whereas being in a band, you know, you need a drummer, you need drum mics, you need a room, it has to be properly treated, you know, all those things. It seems like such an ordeal to make a record with a band from the experience I had with that. It was now something I could do in a bedroom. So when I started getting into that, I was working on this project that I did get signed to Maverick with through Warner Brothers. And it was just a really cool experience to, like, you know, be on a major label for the first time. I was really young, you know, going to LA and all that stuff, you know, whatever. But that was my first experience being on a label. And then, you know, a year later I was dropped and like right back in starting from scratch. And it wouldn't be like a few more years till I actually signed with Cash Money and had like the first real success in the world, you know.
And even as a producer, you produced with some of the best, including Timberland. So please keep.
Yeah, well, what had happened was after I got off Maverick, I came down to Miami and I met a very good friend, Jimmy Douglas, who was, you know, producer, engineer, also worked with Timbaland, was mixing all those records, Missy Elliott, Justin Timberlake, Nelly Furtado, all the stuff he was doing probably at that one of those peak times. And I started I didn't really even care much about playing guitar in it. I just wanted to be a part of that. I knew if I could kind of like go there and soak that up and soak that in, then that would make me the producer that I wanted to be. And again, don't forget, it was like different times. It's not like now where you go on the internet, go, okay, how does it make a beat? And type it in Google. Yeah, cool. All right, let me download those loops. And yeah, it didn't work like that back then. You used to like wait, you know, I wanted to like wait for Timbaland to fall asleep so I could grab his drums out the drive, you know what I mean? And bring them home, because it was hard. You couldn't get drums like that. Like there was no drums, like there was no splice, there was none of that stuff that exists today for like the modern producer. Now it's easy, you know, you just download whatever you want and like you're halfway there. But back then I really wanted to just absorb myself. I felt like very, very called to it. And my way in and my way of sort of adding value while I was there was playing guitar on those records. So I ended up working on, you know, Nelly Furtado and to Lil' Kim to Missy Elliott to all those things, some Justin Timberlake stuff. And it gave me the entrance into that world. You know, it was also a really exciting time in hip hop where, you know, it was like kind of like that prime early 2000s, you know, the parking lot at the Hit Factory, the Bentleys, the Diamonds, the life, the thing, the dream was right in front of me, you know. It's actually like probably the rock star dream that I had as a kid in rock bands was right in front of me in hip hop.
Thank you for that answer. And even following on from that, in 2007, you met with Birdman and his brother, Ronald Slim Williams. Please tell us about the story about how you signed to Cash Money Records.
Sure. Yeah. My friend, he had moved down. He was an engineer at the time and he was in Virginia and he moved down. He was looking for a job as an engineer, and he ended up a few weeks later as the in-house engineer at Cash Money. And I had met Slim and Baby before, like kind of in passing, just being at the Hit Factory and in Timberland's world. You know, it's like the kind of people walk into other people, other rooms, and you know, hey, what's up? I don't, you know. And they had just signed this girl, a girl named T. Lopez, and she was like kind of like a Latin pop artist, like a Jennifer Lopez type of artist. And my friend had given Slim some like finished songs that I had, and he said, "Oh, he said Slim wants to cut one of these records on T. Lopez." So we, you know, I at this point was in parallel to all this. Had kind of made a decision that I needed to be an artist again. I needed to complete that part. I needed to complete being an artist, because it's always the thing that had given me like the most success, the most vitality, the feeling of really creating all of my own music completely myself. Like, I was one of the bedroom producers before bedroom producers were bedroom producers. You know what I'm saying? Like, I was just sitting there. That's the only way I knew to do it. You know what I mean? So I remember one time Slim actually drove up to where I was living, and I went downstairs and I gave him what T. Lopez and I had cut that day. And I was like, wow, this guy is like driving all, he's so excited to hear this record. He drove all the way here to wait downstairs, wouldn't even come up, wait downstairs in the truck, you know, the whole thing. And when I went down, I gave him a CD. And I said, look, you know, this is my stuff. I want you to check this out too. I had about like six songs in there. He fell in love with this song called Coffee and Donuts. And then we just started talking from there, you know, we just were building, you know, we're kind of just building, you know, the relationship that was just really based on the mutual love of music. There was nothing else to it. He wanted to hear what I was doing. He wanted to hear what I was up to. And it was cool for me at the time, because it gave me kind of like a focus, like, all right, I want to get Slim some more stuff. Didn't really think about so much like signing to Cash Money, because Cash Money at the time, don't forget, at the time was like Wayne, you know, the sort of like the tail end of like the juvenile stuff. You know what I mean? There was no Nicki, there was no Drake. It was very, very, very early on. Like Jay Sean was after me. All that stuff that was more pop leaning, you know, was not there, you know? So We just kept going back and forth, you know. Every couple of weeks, I'd bring him a few more songs. Say, hey, check out this, and then we built it up to the point where he said, you know, I want to sign you. I want to do this, and you know, we got Wayne on Let It Rock, and you know, I mean, literally signed a contract probably like a week before we were shooting the Let It Rock video in Atlanta. It was very slow for a long time, and then it sped up, and then it went really, really fast.
Thank you. And even on the point of Let It Rock is one of those, I think, one of those iconic songs. You look on Spotify, 140 million streams, 55 million on YouTube, four times platinum in terms of album sales, in terms of digital download sales, sorry. So what I wanted to ask is, what is the inspiration behind that song?
You know, that song was written from a place of like a lot of frustration. And I wanted to write a song that would be like a call to war. I wanted to, it's really about exposing hypocrisy with a biblical theme. And it's funny because I've started on TikTok recently, and I talked about the lyrics of it, and people are like, oh, that's a club banger, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, it's not a club banger. That song, it says, I see your dirty face, hide behind your collar of a priest, all that stuff. I go into the meaning of all the lyrics. They're all biblical references. And to me, it's like a call to war. It's exposing hypocrisy. And in the end, about, you know, being true to yourself. That's what that song is about. It's nothing to do with clubs and girls and lights and things and blah, 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 blah. It's nothing to do with that. For some reason, because of the beat, I guess it took off in clubs, and I was aware of like making like records. I was aware of the drums at the time. I was thinking about that too. So it's not that I was completely surprised that it was played in a club, but I was surprised that people didn't read into the lyrics the way I thought they would. You know, I think I went through a period of being like a little bit sort of like depressed about that, because I thought, wow, they don't get it. Like, what? They think this is a club song. And this is a really purely channeled song. You know, I don't feel like I wrote that. I feel like I did make myself available to let that come through me. And I believe that's why it hits people that way.
Thank you. And you even talked about, you know, experiencing kind of like depression as an artist, because you're a well-known artist. How do you kind of deal with the feelings of maybe like depression and anxiety? Because you're, in terms of music, you're right at the top, especially, you know, from 2009 to 2011, your music was played everywhere across the world. So how did you deal with all of that?
Well, I don't think I was feeling it, any of that stuff at the time. You know, I think it's very easy to and I say this to anyone who ever asks me about any kind of advice of making it and all that stuff. It's like there's two sections of it. One is I have nothing going on and I want to be this. And so it's like you're here and that's there and you're trying to figure out how to get there. But the thing is, when you get there, there's a whole new level of life, things, problems, relationships, even with people in your inner circle, what have you. You know, you're now also at the party. So it's like when you're just trying to get into the party, it's one thing. And then when you're at the party, you're like, oh, well, they're sitting over there and I'm not, or I'm sitting here and there, or this is, you know, you sort of, it's a little bit high school-y, especially like in the music industry in a way, you know, and probably with social media, it's even more immediately that, you know? So it was more like I think what I was going through at that time in regards to what I said before that was, it was, I felt sort of misunderstood, you know what I mean? I felt like my album was, I felt like it was like an underground album. I mean, plus the rappers I had on, it was like Nas and Rick Ross and Wayne. And, you know, I thought it was like a kind of like, I didn't think it would be successful commercially. I thought it would be like this critically acclaimed, weird left of center thing. And it's on Cash Money, but it's this guy, but what is it? And I think I was thrust into pop radio because of Let It Rock. And that was the label's doing. And I'm grateful for that because it exposed to so many people and so many people are a fan of that record and some of the other ones. So it was amazing in that regard. I don't have any regrets about it. But I think I felt like misunderstood. And that kind of, I think there's a tendency when things are moving very fast to, when you are misunderstood, it's very easy to sort of catch up with the misunderstoodness and play out the role of who you're misunderstood as in order to keep the train going. You know what I mean? You're on this train and it's moving. You know what I mean? It's not you anymore. You're not sitting there anymore going, oh, okay, like, what am I going to do today? Like, your life is in motion, right? You go on the radio interview with this, you know, and then you're flying over here and then you got this and da, da, da. It's already in motion. So you sort of catch up to this perception, or at least I did. And I think that's why you see a lot of artists like having breakdowns or taking time off or, you know, just completely like just switching gears, because there's a tendency to want to get yourself back and retain who you were that got you there. Does that make sense? So yeah. That's the biggest answer to that question. And then I think it goes on from there, which is like, well, what do you do next? And is it as big as that? Is it different than that? Do I go left? Do I go right? Everyone's saying, just do that magic trick again. And it's like, well, that wasn't a magic trick. That was like my real, you know what I mean? And it's like, well, do the real again then. Do the magic, whatever works, you know? So you've got all this, again, once again, you're in a system to a certain degree that you're not in when you're just making stuff in your room. So I think that's oftentimes, now that I think about it, why you see like an artist, for example, like The Weeknd, who's like very, sort of very pure, you know, or started out that way. And then the minute they get really successful, they kind of are working with all the top singer, songwriter, or top producers, excuse me. You know, you bring in your Max Martins and all those things like that, who are also very talented. But you sort of like don't know what to do anymore. You know, you sort of like don't know what to talk about. You don't know. You can't get back to the bedroom, you know?
Yeah.
Thank you so much for that, and through your late contract with Cash Money, you've had the opportunity to work with some of the biggest artists around, such as Lil Wayne, DJ Khaled, Nas, Rick Ross. So what was it like being signed to Cash Money Records, and what are some of your best memories with the label?
I loved it, you know. I remember being there and thinking, wow, this actually is turning out to be sort of the perfect place for me, because I don't, you know, I can't deal with like the authority that some major labels in the past, I don't think they do it as much anymore, but they sort of try to exude a certain amount of control, and they have a right to do that to a certain degree because they're writing the check. So I understand that logically, but it didn't feel like that with Slim. You know, Baby wasn't so involved till a little bit later, but it was Slim and I building for the most part in the beginning. And it was just very pure based on music. Like, of course he thought about marketing and of course he wants to sell records, but the core of it was he loved what I was doing. You know, he was always just say like, Kev, you're my favorite artist. And I loved that, you know, and I knew I was sort of unique over there in a way and kind of an anomaly. And, it's not the place that's the most organized. It's not the place where, you know, okay, guys, there's a meeting at 2, make sure you're on your, you know, it's, you know, it's going to the studio, it's spending time, it's catching a vibe. It's sometimes people don't show up. Sometimes they do. Sometimes it's later than you think. But in retrospect, you know, those aren't really a big deal. I think as long as you have the creative freedom you want, and it's a little bit of a trade-off. So I had a great time, you know. People sometimes comment or say to me things like, oh, we're in Cash Money, they don't this, they don't. It's like, dude, I had so much fun over there. I have no fucking regrets. What the fuck could I, what could I say? Like, people they don't realize what they're complaining about. I got a record deal. I got a check. I got to put out my music. I had hits. How are you going to be mad at that? It's awesome.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And what are your best memories, maybe whether it be on tour or, you know, recording your album?
Some of my best memory, I mean, probably the two best memories were getting that first verse from Wayne, you know, for Let It Rock, and, you know, listening to it and going, oh my God. You know, don't forget, I was nowhere. Wayne's the biggest artist in the world. So I'm in a bedroom, biggest artist in the world, and we got the verse and listened to it over and over, and then listened to it so many times that we didn't realize there was a second verse. So we let it play, and then, and because we were all like, oh my God, the room, me, Slim, you know, Josh, everyone, we were all like, you know, slapping, oh my God, it's crazy. And then at the end, we were like, he came back again? what? I was like, it's over. It's over. I was like, it was, everyone around me was like, better get ready to get on the roller coaster because you about to go. You about to go. I mean, and I was like, here we go. You know, no, it's no longer, you know, you come right up against your fears. It's like, sort of like being a boxer, you know. I was watching one of my favorite movies the other day, When We Were Kings, with Muhammad Ali and George Foreman. And it's one thing to be like, I'm going to kill him. 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 I'm the best. I'm the best. And then you're in the ring. And then you're like, got to get it together now. Like, this is going to go. Like, this is it's about to change. So as though some of those moments were amazing, you know, really like special life-changing moments. Also doing the video and, you know, going into this room with, you know, huge soundstage and like 200 extras and, you know, me and Wayne like rocking out for the first time on stage. And that was so much fun. You know, we're also, he's just a pro to the max, you know, and we got to do it a lot. We made a bunch of videos together. So it happened a lot, you know, after that, but that first one was, you know, like, I'll never forget that stuff. That was just so much fun. So much fun.
And even with you now kind of being, you know, away from Cash Money Records, are you and Lil Wayne still in contact or not much anymore?
Yeah. We did a record together a couple of years ago called I Will Not Break. And, you know, I'm sending over some stuff for his new project. And, you know, and here and there, you know, he's always down to, you know, he's always been supportive of my music, you know, anything I've created. So, you know, I'm fortunate in that way, and he's the greatest. So, you know, yeah.
That's really nice to hear. And, you know, in 2008, your second album in the city was released via Cash Money Records. What are some of the benefits and challenges of being signed to a major label?
There's a lot of both, and they are ever changing. I'd say, you know, I can tell you at the time, it didn't feel like a major label to a certain degree because of Cash Money. You know, it felt like you were family there. It did have that feeling, you know, even if it's dysfunctional at times, it is still that level of support. And that gave me a certain feeling of a certain kind of like certain swagger going into Universal, because Cash Money inherently had a lot of pull at the time. So it didn't feel like just being signed to Universal where you go and they go, okay, well, we want to do this and this and this and this. And you go, okay. You know, I had a layer of protection, which is why I was grateful for them at the time. And I think the advantage of being on a major label is you have infinite reach in terms of possibilities of marketing, licensing, and mainly a radio team. If you are a radio artist, again, things are different now. You know, I think they're looking for things to blow up on TikTok before they start. They do radio campaigns, but they were doing like full blown radio campaigns. And if you had something that felt like a hit record, they were going to spend the money on it and make it happen. And I'm grateful to that radio team. Those guys were amazing. They broke records for me, like in the most like classic breaking records of radio way, you know, they really did it. They went in, and I'm grateful for that. And then you're on a major label, so you can get a booking agent. You can do all those kinds of things that come with it. Again, probably much more important then than it is now, just because all those things are sort of available to everybody. And then you have the benefit and the non-benefit of the fact that they can see in real time if you're reacting with the public. So whereas before, you know, they're going to do a radio campaign and see if the record works to people's ears and really try to get it up the charts and let the public decide. Now they're looking to see how your TikToks and your socials are doing to see if they should continue to promote you. So it's sort of like they have this everyday metric that's going on. So they're kind of like dipping their toe in the water a little bit more in that way. Having said that, they're also signing artists mostly who are blowing up on TikTok and social media. So it becomes more like a later step in the game. You know, you sort of get to like level 5 by yourself and then they can take you to 10 or whatever. I still think there's a lot of value in doing a record deal, but there's a lot of downsides depending on how your deal is structured and how long you could be in it. And, you know, if you're in a deal for you could be in a deal for 6 albums, which would be 10 years or more, and you don't even know it's going to be working there in that time. So there's so many pros and cons to it. I don't think anyone can say they're useless and you don't need them. And I don't think you could say that they're necessary either. It just depends on the kind of career you want to have. And it depends on you as a person and also who's at that label and who's championing you there. There's a lot of factors.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that. And have there ever been times where you wanted to release music, but, you know, being part of a major label, they wanted to maybe, you know, focus upon marketing another artist, so some of your music got put on the back shelf? Because I've heard stories of that happening in the past.
Yeah, I mean, they always have a lot of artists. I think I was very fortunate in that I had a lot of success with the very first thing that we did, and a lot of success. So there was a certain grace period of time where they would push. But I was in a record deal before that, and I know the feeling of being on the back burner. And I also know the feeling of when you give them a single and you're like psyched about it and they're psyched, and then they go to radio, and in 3 weeks you get like an eh from radio, and they're just not, they're canceling your radio promo tour, and they're not going to go all the way, and they're not going to spend the money in the video. Again, you have to accept your product, you know. Having said that, I think the beauty of this modern day and age is even if you are in a label, you have all the tools available to you to blow yourself up, like on TikTok, for example, that would reignite that excitement at the label if their radio campaign didn't work. Or you have a lot of leverage, a lot of power, and a lot of tools at your disposal to really like brand yourself, get yourself out there, show people who you are. Because whether you're doing well or not, that's sort of what's expected anyway, you know?
Thank you so much for that. And just following on from that, your another single that you released, I Made It, Cash Money Heroes, went platinum in the USA and sold over 1 million downloads. What advice would you give to aspiring rappers and artists that want to make an impact on the hip-hop music industry?
In the hip-hop music industry or in just in general?
Actually, no, I'll generalize it a bit more in the music industry.
Well, the first thing you should do is love what you do, right? You have to like really love doing it, because if you love doing it, you'll do it a lot. If you do it a lot, you'll get good. You get good, things will start to happen. So that's a given, right? You shouldn't do it if you don't love it. It should feel like a path for you. It should feel like something you're just sort of destined to do, you know? I feel that way. I think you have to have a belief in yourself. The most important thing is your own mindset and your belief in yourself. It supersedes talent. It supersedes any kind of connections or anything. All of it starts in your own mind and all your beliefs, and you have to know what you want to achieve. Having said that, I think the best action to take is to make music every day, to release as much of it as possible. You don't get penalized for records people don't like anymore. Nobody starts to hate you and stops liking you because you put something out they don't like. You know, I'm only realizing that now. I was going through a process where I thought, oh my God, if I release something, what if the fans don't like it? What if I don't like it? What if they don't like it? What if it's too left? What if it's too right? And I'm realizing now that, you know, everything really is a stepping stone. And if you don't like this, you like the next one. I'm not stopping. So if I'm not stopping and I'm going to keep doing it, what's the difference, right? I don't look at like, even people now, people say, how's the single doing? It's like, I don't care. I mean, I care, but like, I'm in the business of like making stuff, you know, that's like what I like to do. And I like to put it out. So having said that, you know, I think in this day and age, the best thing you can do is make as much music as possible. Obviously make it as good as possible. You know that, everyone knows that. You want to do your best work, whatever that means to you or for you, and put as much out and share as much of yourself as possible and show as much of yourself, whether that's something that you naturally are or an identity you want to project. But I think, I just don't think you can win in any way without being very present on social media in terms of showing yourself, your craft, your music, your stuff, your ideas, talking, thinking, whatever that means to people. And then the next steps are, you know, really what happens after that is kind of what comes to you. You know, you whatever, plant your garden and the butterflies come. That's the concept, you know? If you want a major label deal and you have people that know people, of course, make that phone call, share your work, show your work. But I think a lot of it comes from going back to making a lot of music, because if you make stuff that you really love and you're really proud of, you're going to have a fire burning inside you of passion, and that passion is going to make you want to share it, right? Like, even if you just like, you call from you like, oh my God, check this shit out, I just made, you know, and then you send it to them, like, that's infectious. And then they send it to a friend, and then you post it and you go, guys, like, I know this is crazy and I just made this thing and I don't know if you're going to like it or not, blah, 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 whatever. And then you put it out, and then you just keep doing that. You just keep going back to that part of yourself, which feels really free and creative and passionate, you know? Obviously, there's a lot of other layers. If you're a rapper, yeah, you should have a fucking name and an identity and something that you're embodying that makes you special and to differentiate yourself. I personally think all those things should come from within. But dude, you can also have fun with it and just create a character and be whoever you want to be too. So there's just no rules. There's no anything. It's just in doing it, have fun. Like, if you're fun, you're loose. If you're loose, you're creative. If you're creative, things happen. So just, you know, I got into music because I didn't want to go to school. I didn't want to get a job. So now why would I want to take music that seriously? You got to think about that. People take this shit so seriously now. Like, they really do. Like, they're like, I don't know, my career isn't going on. I was like, what are you, a lawyer? You're fuckist. Make art. Shut the fuck up. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You just be having fun and doing it. And if it's going to happen, it's going to happen.
Thank you for that. And in 2015, you left Cash Money Records. What were some of the reasons why you left? And how have you reinvented yourself as an independent artist?
You know, I'm constantly in the reinvention process. I have a lot of love for Cash Money and Universal. I have all good memories and good feelings about it. I think sort of different people were sort of working in different departments and sort of sensed that the sort of excitement around me was sort of kind of dying out a little bit. I was noticing that Cash Money had kind of signed a lot of artists. Universal suddenly had a lot of artists. There was a lot to weed through. And wasn't sure I was going to get the attention there that I was wanting. Having said that, it's also partly my own doing, because I was very focused for a few years on outside writing and production. And, you know, I was living in Nashville. I just had a hit with Keith Urban. I was like doing, I was hopping around to different things too. So I can't fault them for any kind of waning excitement either. You know, I'm partly responsible for that. And had I kept making like the Kevin Rudolf records that they were used to and pumping them in there, you know, constantly to them, I could have like fanned the flame of that too. So I don't fault anybody. It was probably more my own doing and choosing at that time, but that's life. You know, you go through phases and you're creative doing this thing and then you step back, and that's part of the journey, and the journey is never over. So, you know, the reinvention process, I think, is still continuing to a certain degree, in the sense that like I'm getting like really excited again creatively, and things I want to do and places I want to take it. And the format we're in now, where you once again, you can just put stuff out, there's no penalty. I think I just see it as like the world is a big canvas and just start throwing paint on it and have fun.
Thank you for that. And would you ever sign to a major label again? Because I know that you're currently independent and your new material is amazing, but would you want to ever sign to a label?
No, it's something I would always consider. You know, everything, don't forget, you know, everything is not really major or independent or this thing or that thing. It's really about people, right? So if there was a person and it was at a label and there was a real connection, a real sense of what could be accomplished by being there, and the vibe was right and everything felt good creatively, of course I would be open to it. It's really just about people. It's not really about the company or not. You know what I mean? It's about like, if there was someone at a label that was like, yo, I want to do this. And I'm like, all right, let's go. Sure. Possibly.
Thank you for that. And you know, even as a producer, you're highly successful. You produce hits for, as you mentioned, Keith Urban, but also what people might not know, Selena Gomez as well, and other well-known artists. So what does it take to become a top producer in the music industry?
You know, once again, it's ever changing. So it changes, I think, like every 6 months. Depends on what you want to do. Like I said, if you want to be in the hip hop world, I think it's a two-step process, really simple. And they're both, and it's really kind of easy because it's very simple. And the only problem is there's a ton of competition, but just make hot as f- beats and like network the shit out of it. Like literally just meet people, you know, so just show up to studio, show up to people, DM people, you know, hit people up, just get in the flow of getting with artists, with labels, with anyone in and around connected to it. And I still have a lot of friends who do that. And that's it. It's really simple. Like get in and around it. You know what I mean? Make the best stuff you can make and get in and get around it and co-produce with people. Just do as much as you can with as many people as you can. I don't care if it's independent or major labels, or do whatever you can do to get your momentum going, but it's highly like relationship based, you know. In the pop world, probably it's still that too. It's become more of that. It's less of like you're the hot producer and the label's like, we're going to get so-and-so to do this. You know, we're going to get Kevin to do this. We're going to get this person to do it. I think it's become very collaborative, and there's pros and cons with that. So I think once again, it's about the network, the hang, getting in it, getting around it, going to the sessions, being a part of it. If you have relationships directly with artists, that's a plus, because then you have a direct line into what you're trying to do. But it is very collaborative. It's very political. It's very sort of like, you know, team based, more so than when I was really in it. So I think it's just about, I think it's highly relationship based, and then just doing your best work, you know, and then getting in front of people and all that, and then navigating that.
Thank you. And the last question I'd like to ask you is, please tell us about some of the projects you're working on in 2023 to 2024.
Yeah, I mean, my main focus is making as much music as I can, putting as much out as I can of my stuff. I do produce from time to time. I am sending some stuff over to Wayne for his next project and things like that. But I'm just really into my stuff right now. Like I'm digging what I'm doing. Like I'm not, you know, I'm on my own journey, and I just want to keep going deeper and I just want to have fun with it, man. It's not that serious. You know, I just want to make like great songs, have fun with this shit. They blow up great. Hopefully they do. And like, I want to make videos that I like. I want to make things that I like. I want to put them out. I want to have people who like them. It's not complicated.
And on your new music, will you be reuniting with any of your old label mates from maybe Universal or Cash Money on any of the tracks?
I never know what's going to happen. You know what I mean? I'm down for whatever. Like, I'm down for whatever.
Thank you so much, Kevin, for such an awesome interview. And I'm just looking forward to your continued journey, and I wish you every continued success.
Appreciate it, man. Thanks so much for having me on.
Thank you, Kevin.
Yeah. Cash money, heroes, private jets, polish, stay sharp.
I look up to the sky, and now the world is mine. I've known it all my life. I made it, I made it. I used to dream about the life I'm living now. I know that there's no doubt.
Chopper burn the smoke, Louis bags, they with a priceless glow. High life, and then get some more. Paradise, the luxury marble flow. When I hit, they hit me full of that cash. More money than I seen in the garbage can. Stunner Island, money and the power. That's how we do it, make it rain, make it shower. Top flow, big time, I'm doing big things. Over city view, ball short, a new range. Flip another hundred, popping, throwing hundreds in a new Bentley. Uptown stunner.
I look up to the sky, and now the world is mine. I've known it all my life. I made it. I used to dream. For the love of the game, funny how things can change. They didn't believe in me, then now they calling my name. Now look who cashed in. They didn't wanna know me back then, but ever since I done gone platinum, everything turned around, and now the sky is falling down. Like my mother made it to the goal line, straight out the huddle. Cash money, gold mine, we just stay loyal. Boy, we getting money like we just found oil. And that's word to my flag. I live first and leave the dead last. I lay it down so hard I got a bed rash, and I just tell them to loaf it when the bread pass. Staring at you from the top of the game, man. I might drop the world if I change hands. It feel good to be here. Weezy in the building, got this rebuild, young money. I look up to the sky, and now the world is mine. I've known it all my life. I made it. Yes I did, yes I did, yes I did, yes I did.
Hi everyone, thank you so much for watching the interview today. Please remember to subscribe to the channel, and I will be back soon with another interview on the Micah McLean Talks YouTube platform. Thank you.